experiments, right? And they do this by having theories, by deriving hypotheses, and again, by designing systematic experiments, Tesla's hypothesis, right? But crucially, like I was saying, not everybody reaches this stage. And the task you use to measure whether or not an adult has reached this stage is that pendulum problem task, right? That's how he would measure it. Now, of course, one concern you might have is, well, you know, maybe there's something, maybe the reason why kids and some adults don't pass that task may have something to do with the aspects of the task that's independent of systematic reasoning. And that's a very valid criticism of Piaget. But in any case, he would use that to assess to what extent they've made it to this last stage, which is not universal, that is, not everybody reaches this stage. All right, so what about Piaget and sort of lasting sort of influence? Well, Piaget has, you know, his insights has influenced discovery learning. So what Piaget observed is that children should be encouraged to discover information for themselves, right? And so the lesson for teachers is that you provide activities to promote exploration and discovery. In terms of sensitivity to readiness to learn, whether or not a kid is ready to learn, Piaget's insight is that learning must be based on the level of the child's thinking, right? And so the lesson is that new skills do not impose until child. You don't try to teach a child a new skill until they have reached that particular stage, right? And there's, of course, individual differences. Some kids are going to be better than other kids, perhaps because they have better working memory, better information processing capacities, among other things, right? So he also emphasizes individual differences. All right, so what about some of the weaknesses? Right. There are many, but I'm going to list a few of them. The first is that the stage model, this idea that children develop in stages, right, depicts their thinking as being more consistent than it is. Something I had mentioned is that you can take the same child, test the same child on the same task on different days and observe different performances. But when you read Piaget, you get the sense that all kids pass through each stage, with the exception of the last stage, and they do it at the exact same point. But that's not the case when you actually test children. And I think part of the problem is that Piaget samples were really, really small. And in most cases, it consisted only of his own children. Secondly, infants and young children are more cognitively competent than Piaget recognized. So object permanence is this capacity that doesn't come online, according to Piaget, until they are at the very back end of the sensory motor stage. So we're talking about almost 2 years of age, right? However, there's a really interesting research by Rene Bayerjohn, for example, that you'll read, that demonstrates that infants as young as 3.5 months of age can show object permanence if you use tasks that don't require them using their motor abilities, right? A 3-month-old is not very sophisticated in carrying out motor actions and motor plans, right? And so there has to be another way of testing something like object permanence. And so when you read Bayerjohn, you'll see a different way. So what she shows is that this capacity is probably online well before they are 2 years of age or 12 months of age, right? This capacity, there's an argument to be made that this capacity is online by the time they're about 3 months of age, right? So he, in a lot of cases, underestimated. Moreover, he didn't focus on social factors, right? Although we know we grow up in a social world, and as Vygotsky, as I'll talk about today, for Vygotsky, learning and cognitive thinking is a function of our experience with a more informed other and our experience in the social world, right? And then finally, Piaget's theory, and to me this is probably one of the most damning criticisms, is that Piaget's theory sort of doesn't articulate mechanisms for how children go from one stage to the next. So as I talked about, you may be thinking, what are you talking about? You talk about assimilation and accommodation. Those are mechanisms that contribute to continuous development and thinking. But he never articulated the mechanism by which a child goes, or at least not clearly, by which a child goes from one state to the next. It just sort of happens, right? Sort of magic. At least that's the impression we're sort of left with when we read Piaget. That can't be the case. Dana.
So I'm just curious, for example, object permanence in infants of 3.5 months old, what would that be?
What would an example?
Yes.
Read the Bayerjohn paper. There's an example of that paper. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, thank read you. The Bayerjohn paper. It's in that paper. Yep.
Cool.
Okay. All right. So we've wrapped up Piaget. Does anyone have any questions about Piaget? Yes, Marshall.
I guess my question is, like, why Piaget's theory is considered discontinuous in the sense.
takes influences and say, says that children learn through assimilation and accommodation, which are continuous processes. And he says that those then impact, like, for example, when you're trying to teach, or when you're trying to get a child to learn a different stage, you give them, like, certain tools and processes that help them bring about that development. So, like, I guess in, like, a Piaget theory, you would emphasize nurture or nature more than nurture, because at the end of the day, each child, regardless of what they learn, should be able to reach each stage. Right?
Yes.
So I guess I don't understand that distinction.
Yeah, Piaget was vague about this particular point. The thing he was clear about, though, was that there's two kinds of development. There's a discontinuous aspect. This is where the stage theory comes into play. And then there was a continuous aspect. Piaget held that these are two completely separate aspects, right? So for continuous development, cognitive thinking, what that means, of course, my thinking at this point was influenced by my thinking at an earlier point. We have mechanisms like assimilation and accommodation. Now, for the discontinuous aspects, those mechanisms, according to Piaget, have no influence on how we go from one stage to the next. Now, your question was, well, in what sense is it discontinuous? Well, this is the sense in which it's discontinuous. Piaget argues that, this is where he is quite clear, that what children can do at one stage has no relation to what they can do at another stage. It just sort of happens. But he doesn't articulate a clear mechanism, a clear process by which a child goes from one stage to the next. So in that sense, it's discontinuous. There's no clear continuity in how in one stage, in an earlier stage, and a later stage. That's how I agree. It's a bit vague on that point.
Yeah, I just think that's kind of, I don't know if that's true, just because, like, if you aren't able to, like, in the pre-operational stage, if you aren't able to understand symbolic representation, then how in the concrete operational stage or formal operational stage are you able to make hypothetical situations based on symbols?
Advances, so what he would argue, again, he wouldn't posit that assimilation and these other mechanisms are driving that. What he would posit is that these information processing systems are what's driving development. But those systems by themselves cannot explain how a child goes from one stage to the next. That would be the explanation. So when you read Piaget, those are the kind of explanations he gives. So those advances that you're talking about, which do in fact happen, are not a function of assimilation and accommodation, they're a function of better memory, better working memory, better short-term memory, better long-term memory. These are the processes. But again, those processes by themselves do not account for how you go from one stage to the next. There's no clear basis for that. That's the kind of idea. Any other questions? That's a good question. Great questions. Any other questions? All right. So we're going to now turn to information processing theory, speaking of information processing. And so overall, proponents of this perspective espouse really two key tenets. So there's two key tenets of the information processing perspective. The first key tenet is that cognitive development is continuous. Remember, later thinking is directly from earlier, by earlier, and what allows to happen, that is, what allows my later knowledge to be influenced by my earlier knowledge, are advances in information processing capacities. We'll talk about some of those. So that's the first key tenet of this perspective. The second key tenet is that a child is a problem solver. They're not passively taking in the world, right? They're encountering problems, they have goals, and they reason about those goals, however systematically, to achieve those goals, right? So they're active problem solvers. They're not, again, just soaking up information, right? That's the second key tenet. And so, to sort of address the second key tenet, proponents of this perspective have used, among many other methods, they've used what's called a task analysis. So this would be an example of a task analysis. So the question is, the first question an information processing theorist might ask is, well, what is the goal of the child? What is the goal of the child in this situation? What is the child trying to do? Yeah, they're trying to open up the mailbox, probably trying to get this letter or something that's in the mailbox, right? But we don't stop there as an information processing theorist. The second question is, well, what are those steps by which they achieve that particular goal? Right, well here, she is clearly stepping on this tricycle, right, and using it as a platform to retrieve whatever's in the mail. So open up the mailbox firstly, so the lid, and then to retrieve whatever's in it, right? So this is how And this is one way in which an information processing theorist assesses how children solve problems. Now, what could be the benefit of a task analysis as opposed to, for example, just asking a child how they solve problems? What could be a benefit?
Richard? To specify the main mechanism, well, not the main, the underlying mechanism in the processing that take place in arriving at a certain decision.
But why couldn't we get at that answer by simply asking, you know?
Children can't exactly articulate what they're
going to do. Exactly. The lack of an answer from a child does not mean that they don't have that, they don't have access to that mechanism or process, right? But children, at a certain age, they're limited in what they can say. So we have to use methods like this to ascertain how they go about solving problems. Another benefit of this kind of analysis is that we can actually identify errors in their thinking, right? So, if she got a blade of grass and tried to take the stem of a blade of grass to get, you know, that wouldn't help, right? But that would allow us to be able to, again, ascertain errors in her thinking in ways that we wouldn't be able to get at by simply asking the child how she or he is going about solving this particular task, right? So that's one approach. Another approach, which is an approach that I adopt, so I am an information processing theorist, and so this is an approach I rely on heavily, and the approach is computer simulations, right? So the question is, well, what is the advantage of computer simulation? Well, firstly, a computer simulation is a way of modeling